Namaste children. In this capsule, we'll be learning about evolution and classifications. Evolution and classifications, these two terminologies are extremes of biology, I should say. They don't have any formal connection between them. The word evolution means the change. The change might be something which occurs in an organism, or it might be something which occurs in an environment also. Even our earth might have undergone a kind of evolution. So what does this word classifications means? Classifications are the categorization of organisms based on characteristics. Here, we need to look into the term called as characteristics. How could we define a characteristic? Characteristic is something which is constrained with the structure and the behavioral form of an organism. So it deals about or it deals with structure or the function or the behavioral form of an organism. Characteristics could be defined as the structure or the behavior which is manifested by an organism. If I show you this figure, what will be your inference, children? Yeah, you would say these are chimpanzees, this is a human, isn't it? This is a chimpanzee. This is a human. So it's a kind of an integrated image. There you could see both. Then what will be your next inference? Yeah. Now we'll say that both are a kind of closely related organisms. Isn't it, children? When I add on another image along with, what will be your inference now? Yeah. You would conclude that these two organisms are quite similar with each other, irrespective of this one. How could you say so? You could conclude this by looking into their structural similarities. Isn't it? When I ask you, or when I add another image along with this, the image of a plant and the image of a cyanobacteria. This photograph is an example for, is a photograph of cyanobacteria. When you look into their behaviors, both the plants and cyanobacteria are photosynthetic in nature. What does it mean? They both could prepare their own food. Now, together for all the organisms, if I would like you to categorize, you would categorize them as prokaryotes, animals. You would categorize them as prokaryotes, animals, and plants. How such a distant classification you could do, or how could you classify them based on some hierarchies which you have followed? It is based on purely their structural and the behavioral differences which they exhibit. Isn't it, children? So the characteristics could be defined as which is pertaining to structural and the behavioral form of an organism. Isn't it? Now, the next thing is, let's look into this family tree. So this is something which reveals you about the connection between two terms called as evolution and classification. Now, when you look into them, this girl and this boy could be a sibling of each other. You could see them both look similar. Isn't it, children? More or less similar. What does that mean? It means these are the offsprings who show some similarity with their immediate parents. Now, when I say you, these two cousins look similar with each other. What does it mean? Their parents are even not quite similar, isn't it? Or they are not same. How could the cousins look similar then? Either it could be something which is pertaining with their structural characteristic, or which is something other than their structural characteristics, such as behavioral pattern. How could they resemble same then? It is because they might be having their super ancestors, which are common, who is common for both of them. So based on this classification, or based on this categorization of individuals, based on their characteristics, you can track their evolutionary relationship. Now, how could we do this? How could the evolution could be traced up? Or the array or the pattern of divergence of a part of evolution which happens among the organisms? That could be done with the help of two techniques. One, by looking into their structural similarities or the differences, or the second thing by looking at the fossils. Now, the first thing is tracing evolutionary history based on their structure. The first image shows you the homologous organs. The organs which have similar structure with different functions. They have similar structure with different functions. Whereas here, you could see two analogous organs which are different in structure but similar in functions. Isn't it, children? They look similar in structure, called as homologous. The organs which look similar in function, which have similar functions, could be called as an example for analogous organs. What is the structural similarity which you could see here, children? Yeah, they all share the common anatomical structure of their forelimbs, isn't it? So, with this, you could definitely tell them this could be an example for a forelimb, which is an example for a homologous organs. Now, the thing is, these forelimbs are shared by most distant species, such as frog, lizard, bird, and human. All these have a common or fall under a common category called as vertebrates. So in general, we can say all the vertebrates share homologous forelimbs. They have the same structured forelimbs which might be employed for different functions. Isn't it, children? Whereas contradictory, here you could see the structure of forelimb which is present in bird and the structure of forelimb which is present in bats. You could see the bats, however, you could see they have elongated fingers, or otherwise called as elongated phalanges, where these elongated phalanges are stretched with skin folds. Whereas here you could see the bird's arms consist of feathers. Throughout the arm of a bird, it is covered with the feathers that will constrict the wing structure for them. So, when you look into them structurally from outside, you could see both of them look quite similar. Isn't it, children? Am I right? Are they structurally similar? Absolutely not. They are structurally dissimilar by having elongated phalanges with skin folds in the backs and the short phalanges with the feathers throughout in the birds. That makes them as a good example for analogous organs or the analogous organisms. This could be an evidence to identify the evolutionary relationship between the organism. So what could be the conclusion over here? Just tell me about homologous organisms, or with the help of homologous organ, what you could trace out. Yes. You could say very simply that all the vertebrates might have originated or might have had a common ancestor. Whereas in case of the analogous structures, you could also say the structures are dissimilar. So though they look structurally similar from outside, they may not be similar, and they might have the different structure which might be conversed to do same function. The bats use wings to fly the same as that of the birds, but they are structurally distinct. The second mode by which we can identify or trace out the evolutionary relationship could be with the help of fossils, or we call it as fossilized evidences. How could we do this, children? What are fossils, first of all? Yes, the preserved forms of life, or the creatures which are having preserved, could be called as fossils. So when you look into the picture, you could trace out some of the organisms over here. What is this? Yeah, this is a trunk of a tree. This is a kind of ampelite which had been sedimented millions of years ago. It is just an example for an insect. The same over here. It is also an example for invertebrate. This is an example for fish, which has been sedimented long millions of years ago. This is very well known example called as Rajasaurus, or otherwise an example for dinosaurs. So these are the fossil evidences which are still providing to assist us in tracing out the evolutionary history. Now, let's look onto a visual to know how to study the age of a fossil. If suppose you are finding out any fossil at any surface nearby, you need to know whether it is the fossil of an organism which has happened just now, or it is the fossil which has been sedimented long before. So this video will show you how all fossils get formed. Of course, I think you can just track out what is this organism, isn't it? This is a dinosaur which might have had a bad day, where it got its deathbed, it went to its deathbed. It has been infested by most of the dinosaurs and get deposited under the mud. Later, when muds keep on being deposited, when they crust on, this rocks get sedimented for 100 million years, with 45 million years of sand being deposited over and 5 million years of volcanic ash. After all these sedimentations, you could of course trace down this dinosaur fossil if natural selection of Earth has fortunated us to look into. That would happen during uplifting of rocks. What is called as uplifting of rocks, where sometime the rocks might be uplifted, where most sedimented particles which are present in deep of the Earth crust could be excavated out. Either it could be due to sand, water or anything else, but due to that excavation, you may or we may fortunate to see the broken bones of dinosaurs, which have so been suppressed inside the sedimented rocks. This is how the fossils are formed. It is very possible for any of us to look into any fossilized organisms near the sand shore, because 99% of organisms seem to be fossilized in the sand shore or in the aquatic marine conditions. So, if suppose you are standing nearby a seashore, please do expect a kind of fossil which you might be fortunate to touch with. Evolution by stages. Now, the question comes, how does evolution happen? In the very beginning of evolution, or while reading about the heredity, you might have crossed through a word called as variations. When the variations keep on accumulating due to the mistake or the error which happens in DNA replication, that ultimately leads to evolution. Isn't it, children? So, let's talk about the stages for which any organ or any organism might have adapted for long billion years to take up its final form. Let's see the first example of eyes. What do you think, children? What do you think over here? Eyes are the structure, the more complex structure which are formed very instantly or very immediately due to some variation which happened in DNA? Obviously not. It might be because of the variations which had accumulated bit by bit over generations. So the accumulation of variations bit by bit over generation might have led to this final structure which is adopted and accepted by many of us. Isn't it? Could you imagine a life without the spots on your face, without the eye outlet? Of course not. This is the very first creature called as Planaria, which seemed to be fortunate with the eye spots which are present, which was present just to catch up the light. The next stage of this eye spot could be the presence of rudimentary eyes, which could be seen in most of the insects, which were employed for vision. And of course, you know what are the other forms the eyes took up till the human to function as a very important optical agent. Isn't it, children? Now the next thing is, let's see about the dinosaur which got embedded in the mud before 100 million years. How does it happen? We don't need to bother about how does it happen, but what is the actual implication out of this image is the presence of feathers. Could you see the feathers here, children? See, you can't see, of course, the feathers over here, but you could see the feather imprints over there. Isn't it true? The presence of feather imprints will give you a conclusion that the dinosaurs were fortunate to have feathers. The feathers have a long history, and you go back. They were not the organs which were meant for any organism to fly. Whereas those were the structures which were present to give an insulation property for any organism to prevent or protect themselves from coldness. But later, this figures acts as an evidence for the structure which were formed for some other reason, but later might have been employed or involved in some other function. Now, of course, you know what for the feathers are used for. What for children? Yes, to fly, isn't it? So with the help of feathers, we could even track out an evolutionary relationship between the birds and the dinosaurs. Now you could say, or many of the evolutionists will say, that reptiles will lead to, or in other words, the birds could be a descendant of reptiles. So there is a good connectivity could be seen between the dinosaurs and the present day birds. Artificial selection. So far we have seen what is about evolution, what could be defined as classification, or about the characteristics, and what is the relationship between evolution and classification, or how we can trace down the evolutionary relationship, etc. But now we're going to see about artificial selection, where the man has intervened to something or to do something with a nature's product that might have led to so many diverged varieties. Let's take this example of a cabbage family, where you could see this one as the wild type. This is the original cabbage form which we supposed to have, or which had been selected by nature. But later, due to man intervention, maybe because of many farmers who might have liked to have certain vegetables which might have shorter distance between the leaves. So they might have produced something called as cabbage. If they wanted some cabbages where the floral development is arrested, they might have formed broccoli. Then the cauliflower. Cauliflower is the sterile variety of cabbage. Then if they might have wanted to have the vegetables with a long leaf-like structure, then they might have produced this kale. What would be the identification or inference out of this artificial selection, children? Yes. Because of man's intervention, he had just made lot more mutations or variations in the wild variety that led to the formation of these many diverged vegetable forms. Now the question comes, if suppose nature has done the same mechanism or natural selection had happened, would we have get the same varieties of these vegetables? What should be the answer? Maybe or may not be, but it may not be, of course, so rapid as what happened as a result of human intervention. Molecular phylogeny. So far, we were discussing about the techniques or the evidences through which we can trace down the evolutionary relationship. We had gone through the presence of fossils as a very good evidence to look into the evolutionary relationship. We have even seen about the structural similarities or the differences may categorize the organisms under some classification. And we had even seen through certain stages through which we can see or we can classify again the organisms of having the formal eyes from where they might have come from. The fourth important technique which is highly prevailing now or today is molecular phylogeny. Phylogenetics is the branch of science which deals with evolutionary relationship. Phylogenetics is the branch of science which deals with evolutionary relationship between the organisms. Evolutionary relationships between the organisms. How could this happen? This happens by comparing this DNA structure between the organisms. With the high throughput techniques of molecular biology, we could now come to a situation where we don't need to look rather into the homologous structure, and we no more depend on the fossils which have been sedimented through, but we highly depend on the molecular structure which will make us to understand the compatibility or similarity between the organisms. With the help of this molecular phylogenetics, the famous conclusions had come, the famous data have come, or the reports have been submitted stating that chimpanzees and the human share about 99% of their genome. Evolution should not be equated with progress. It's a very important topic to be discussed to children. There were nothing which is dealt with the progress and the evolution. For suppose if I say organism A gets evolved to form B and C. But now we could see only B and C on the earth. For example, you considered wolf and dog over here. Both were common resembling, both shares most of the similarities. So we can consider that they might be from the same ancestor, isn't it? But it doesn't mean that A is not survival of fittest. Isn't it, children? If I say, just look into this diagram, you could see most of the bacteriums or the microorganisms could survive even inside of us, isn't it? So because of having self-consciousness, because having some more sense organs, could we say that the human are the most evolved species comparatively? Of course not. Could the human live in the extreme conditions as the bacterium to live? For example, the archaebacteriums can live in extreme hot springs, or it could live in even thermal vents. It could live in a very cold areas. Do you think the human could also be adapting to so extreme varieties of conditions of the habitat? Certainly not. So it doesn't mean that evolution is the one which decides the progress. Evolution is something which is selected by the organism. Evolution is something which leads to the organisms, diverse varieties of organisms, just the product of sexual reproduction. Finally, it has to be accredited and selected by the nature, and they come to play. Doesn't matter about the survival of fittest and all. If dinosaurs might be here, they might have not been evolved so much. Isn't it, children? So the evolution could not be equated with the progress of species. Now, next important condition which we need to discuss with. Are we and chimpanzees are same? Certainly not. Just now I told you we share 99% of similarities, but it doesn't mean we are similar. We do have 1% of dissimilarity, isn't it? What does it mean, children? It means we are different from each other, because we are talking about the similarities and dissimilarities at the genetic level. Each human shares 0.1% of dissimilarities in their genetic makeup. The dissimilarity between the human and chimpanzee is about 1%. That is quite large when you think in genetic view. Now the thing is, the question is, are we both similar? Certainly not. Then what does it mean? We might be the organisms who have been formed from the common ancestors. Just because of having a greater similarities between us and the chimpanzees, we can come to the conclusion stating that we might be having a common ancestor. Human evolution. It is ultimate for us to know about how we have evolved out. And before knowing about how the evolution of human happened, it is mandatory for us to know, based on the races or the skin color, no human could be separated from other. You can't separate the population based on the color. Somebody being saying is a white or black or brown or yellow, something like that. So there is not anything called this or any concept called this racism based on genetics. We all are human. You could not be separated based on the color which we have. The thing is, now we're going to see about how does the human evolution had happened. We could see our genetic footprints back about million years as were rooted in South Africa. We might have started to travel from South Africa to West Asia, then Central Asia, then Eurasia, then to East Asia, and might have come to Indonesia, Philippines, and then to Australia, and we might have took a circle to reach out to America. The bridge to reach out from the Australia to the America, which is used by humans, called as Bering Bridge from Australia to North America. Now, what is supposed to know or get concluded from this traveling of human? It means that they might have not navigated in search of food. because you could see them back to Africa again sometimes. You could see some of the human population which had been traveled from the Central Asia to Africa again. So it might be, they might be traveling to find out the best place to adopt and survive and to extend their lineage. This distribution of Homo sapiens into different parts of the world might not lead to the conclusion that they were searching for food or they didn't have a good place for their survival. But they might be the organism which was searching all around to find out best place for their living. Namaste, children.